You may have noticed two things about today. The average age of the APL community has dipped slightly. The mean age has lowered slightly. And to compensate, the mean attractiveness of the APL community has risen slightly. I'm supposed to, Fiona wants me to say, as there are young people here, and I'm going to say this verbatim because I have no idea what it means. I'm supposed to say hashtag Dyalog15. So you could twitterate or something if you see something. APL was designed as a notation for communicating ideas initially before it became a language. And to see APL being communicated to young people is a dream come true for us today. So I'd like to introduce Roberto, Minervini, and four of the students who are going to talk about APL in an Italian school.
Okay, hello everyone. Ciao a tutti. And I apologize to you because this is not a technical presentation. We are going to speak about APL, but mainly we are going to speak about education. Actually, the title of our presentation is a question. It's a question for many reasons. First, because I'm not sure that Italian school need to be saved. And second, because I'm not sure if APL could be successful where brilliant Italian politician failed. Thank you, Dyalog, Mort and Gitan, for believing in us and for giving us the opportunity to present our work. Caro Alberto, Stefano and APL Italiana for teaching me what problem solving is about. And last but not least, to my student for having engaged in the challenge of learning APL. The presentation is divided in four parts. First, we are going to speak about education. Second, about teaching. In the third, we are going to speak about mathematics teaching. And in the last one, we are going to speak an APL approach to do math. About me. I work as an APL programmer for APL Italiana for 5 years. But last year I decided to quit and devote myself to teaching in public secondary school. Someone think that I met. In spite of my quitting the previous sector, I have never abandoned APL. For this reason, I asked my head teacher to give me the chance to teach programming at school. Since I met the APL, I always thought it would be an extraordinary tool for teaching mathematics. And now I leave the word to my student, Kariman. She is very brave. She is 14. And she is not scared to speak in public.
About us. We started the APL course among us, but essentially we have enthusiasm for staying. We decided that on each day of our meeting at school, some of us should cook something yummy to enjoy. I'm not sure that we have learned a lot about APL, but what I'm certain about is that we have a lot of fun and we have tasted very good food.
Okay. And now I leave the word to another my brilliant student, Arianna. She is a romantic student.
I'm not addicted to the computer. I'm just lucky if I manage to type this introduction. I've always preferred pen and paper to the keyboard, and I often overlook many advantages the use of a PC can entail. I realize that all this technology that surrounds me has still a huge potential that I don't know. The absence of a computer lesson at school certainly doesn't help. When our teacher announced the coming of APL for the first time, I didn't have a clue of what it was. He suggested us to start learning by using it. To introduce it, He showed us how to solve a Sudoku. Step by step, he made a function borrowed from John's calls, which permits to resolve those enigmas in only one click. I thought about all my half hours spent in front of those squares. In that moment, an animate computer was laughing at me. We had been meeting after lunch once or twice a week. We were a team of 25 people, more or less. While the teacher explained the use of those scribbles, we experimented that immediately on the PC. I was enthusiastic of it. This software allows to transmute the reasoning of my brain into a language understandable to a computer with its own alphabet that permits to communicate with it. If with the pen, you can describe the feelings or tell a story. With APL, you can codify the logic. Then you can read it, summarize it, shape it, and admire it. I found the language of the future.
Okay. When I got started to teach, I is in front of this kind of paradox. We are living in the present, we have to prepare the student for the future, and we have school meant for the past. But what the future will hold, so how we can prepare children for something unknown. Our schools are intended for industrialists, said Ken Robinson. The school system is structured like an assembly line. Classes are formed according to the student age and not to their interests. Students must stick to a rigid curriculum and cannot choose the subject they like. And the biggest problem is that they also have to ask for permission to go to the toilet. Solutions. What are solutions that our politicians thought? Tougher competition between schools, stronger accountability for student achievement, performance-based pay for teacher, opening more charter school. It seems to be that we keep doing the same things while expecting to get different results. What about Italy? We do the same. The current Italian government has launched a big school reform called La Buona Scuola, the good school, sounds like the good father, to make the Italian school system cool, modern, and efficient. But the result is that people are still a bit confused because they not understand whether politicians or teachers are right. Teachers and politicians are not widely appreciated in Italy. In another country is the same. This is a famous Newsweek cover where politicians and invited people must fire bad teacher. Likely I was not teacher at the time. But what should teacher do? What should we do when every day we go in the classroom, when we enter in the classroom? What should we do as teacher while waiting for politician to understand that today's school is different from school back in the 19th century and to encourage creativity and not competition among students?
Che succede?
Ma come, non se ne accorge che fanno baccano?
Ma allora non mi seguono mai, io sto scrivendo da due ore
e... talmente concentrato a spiegare che non si accorge che i ragazzi...
Ma pensavo fossero attenti, invece no, sta facendo...
Mi dispiace,
non va bene.
Attenti. No, no, no.
E allora qui bisognerà cambiare qualcosa.
Ok, I apologize to you because we don't put the subtitles, but I think the video is clear. I was concentrated on my lesson. Students didn't follow me. They did other things. But I wasn't be able to understand the situation. As long as a caretaker came into the classroom and told me that something it was wasn't working in my lesson. So I promised her that I would have changed something in my teaching. Lizanne Foster is a famous Canadian teacher, secondary school teacher. She said, "I reduced to a minimum the theoretical lesson, and I tried as much as I can to use the program in a way that allows my student a type of learning based on solving problems. When I started, I didn't know how these methods were called. In most cases, build the road walking. I just tried to create meaningful learning experience for students. In my dream, I imagine that learning based on solving problems and on direct experience will be the focus of what we do in public school in the future." What about scientists? Scientists are asking to himself, what really matters in teaching? Researchers are using tools borrowed from medicine and economics to figure out what works best in the classroom. The new methodology is already challenging widely held beliefs. First belief that they are challenging is that failure is bad, but they think that failure is good. I'm very expert about failures in my life. Failure is an essential element of technology and science. You try something, it does not work, then you correct the initial idea and then you try again from another starting point. This is the process that new learning methods hope to recreate in school classroom. There are counterintuitive aspects how we humans learn something new. For example, we like to find out that we had a good idea that is something wrong. In Italy, failures are punished with bad grades. For students who are not learning enough mathematics, a common cure is a revised curriculum with more hours of teaching and additional homework. The increase in workloads can often lead to a further motivation in the student of mathematics. The failure is to be labeled as a bad grade, and anxiety leads students to convince themselves that they are not able to do mathematics. A relaxed culture of learning and lack of stress and anxiety play an important role in the achievement of good overall results in Finnish school.
Bocatella Roberta, 1.5.
And what about mathematics? We start from this book, Mathematician Layment, written by Paul Lockhart, which is characterized by a strongly worded opinion supporting an intuitive and heuristic approach to teaching mathematics. The books frame learning mathematics as an artist and imaginative pursuit which is not reflected at all in the way the subject is taught in the American educational system. Lockhart said, "The first thing to understand is that mathematics is an art. This book reveals maths to be creative and beautiful and rejects standard anxiety-producing teaching methods." He said, "Our present system of mathematics education is a nightmare. The politicians say we need higher standards. The schools say we need more money and equipment. Everyone knows that something is wrong. Students say math class is stupid and boring, and they are right." Why does it not work? The main problem with school mathematics is that there are no problems. Or, I know what I meant by problem in most classes, this insipid exercise. It is a type of problem It is how to solve it. Yes, it will be on the test. Do exercise from 1, 30, 35 odd for homework. But a good problem is something else. You don't know how to solve it. That's what makes it a good puzzle and a good opportunity. Who are the big friendly giants that can cope with these nightmares? The first one is, of course, Paul Lockhart. How do we teach our students to do mathematics? By giving them time to discover something and formulate conjecture. By helping them to refine their topics and create an atmosphere of healthy and vibrant mathematics criticism. By being flexible and open to sudden change in direction to which students' curiosity may lead. And the second one is George Polya. We could consider Polya as the father of problem solving. And now I leave the word to another my brilliant student, Samuele.
So mathematics has two phases. It is the legal science of Euclid, but it is also something else. Mathematics presenting Euclidean way appears as a systematic deductive science, but the real mathematics turn out to be an experimental inductive science. Polya focused on the second aspect, the heuristics, the process of being invented. He wrote a book called After Solving. The aim of heuristic is to study the methods and the rules to discover and invent something. I do not know how heuristics could be taught, but I know what is not be taught at school. The trouble is that math is antiquated work that makes it very difficult to teach. So we choose another way to talk about heuristics. We prepare two videos to show you the two phases of mathematics.
A teacher said me, teacher Minervini, you are losing your work. Okay. What said George Polya about thinking, about teaching? Polya was a brilliant mathematician, but he also was interested in education. What is a good education? Give a systematic opportunity to the student to discover things by themselves. Who is a good teacher? Good teacher are people who should help their students, but not too much and not too little. Not too little because if students are left alone, they may not progress. Not too much because is that way nothing is left to them. Of course, another big friendly giant is Ken Iverson. If Polia described how problem solving is, Iverson gave a language to problem solving. And he understood very well that in mathematics notation is not just the form, but is the sense of thinking. And so he called APL the tool of truth. Can Iverson combine in a single coherent language the advantage of executability and universality found in a language with advantage of mathematical notation? And another big friendly giant is Quentin Blake. Quentin Blake is not a mathematician. He's an illustrator, he's an artist, and he became famous because he illustrated many books of Roald Dahl. And his idea is that when you have to portray an object, person, or animal, the goal is go to straight to the essence of the select subject. This we should give no importance to the appearance of something, but to this something in itself. For example, what has to emerge out of a crocodile is not so much its resemblance to the crocodile in zoos, but rather its crocodileness, which makes it real and familiar to us. APL as tool of truth means for me that APL is the minimalist set of general patterns and ideas to deal with problems, focus on their crocodileness. APL symbols need to draw ideas which compose the image which in turn solves the problem. In notation, there is the sense and not just the form of thinking. What about teaching APL? It is possible to start studying programming with an APL approach for secondary school. Of course, I believe it is possible. It is important for me not to have any imagery in the studio. The walls are white. It is my job to imagine whatever it is I'm drawing. Everything I draw now comes from my own imagination, Quentin Blake said. And I don't miss in my list, of course, Martin Gardner. Martin Gardner was not a mathematician. He was a writer, and he wrote about mathematics and science. I really admire it because he said, I just play all the time and I'm fortunate enough to get paid for it. Okay, and now we are going to put in practice previous idea, taking inspiration from an article written by Dan Barnett, The Tool of Truth. Where is Dan? Hello, Dan. Thank you. And this is a game, Kaguro, and could be a good idea starting programming with a game. Kakura is a mathematical transliteration of crossword. You have to fill the white blanks with number in order that the sum across and down is the number in the corner. The problem that Dan studied is the problem one. In this example, to find four unique positive digit numbers which make up a sum of 29. And then tried the way to showing all solution of this problem. But this problem is also a combinatorial maths problem. So, if you want to show all the solution of the problem, we have a programming problem. While if we want to count how many solutions there are and how big the set of solutions is, this is a mathematical problem. We have two different points of view, programming and mathematical. And when programming problem is too much difficult, we can switch to a mathematical problem. And we do the opposite when the counting solution is very difficult. In order to solve problem one, we study problem two. Problem two is to find three not negative digit numbers which make up a sum of six. we try to solve problem two, and after we removing from solution of problem two solution that contains zero and that are not unique. And we have seven solutions for problem number two and just one for problem number one. And we are trying to apply the mantra of Polya and problem sort. If you can solve a problem, there is an easier problem you can solve. Find it. We repeat this pattern and we try to study an easier problem, problem number three. How many ways can we distribute six sweets between three children? And we have 28 solutions of this problem. And also problem number two has 28 solutions, but more solutions in the problem number two are in problem two are equivalent, and the color is the same. And repeat again, and we are the problem four is equivalent to problem three. How many anagrams of the word sweet sweet child sweet in sense that the first child take three sweets, the second one take two sweets, and the last one just one. And we have also 28 solutions. Okay, we repeat again problem 5 and problem 6, and we arrive to definition of permutation. To deal a deck of 8 different cards means to do a permutation of the first 8 numbers. After learning to count solutions, it is natural to ask how you can create solutions. What tools do we need to create solution? Can we find simple tasks in which decomposing a permutation? A permutation could be decomposing more switch, but if our atomic data is a vector rather than a scalar, this further decomposition would not be right. Teaching APL. Someone might wonder why I have not yet introduced this on an APL symbols. The idea is not giving answer in advance. The idea here is that if you have a lecture first and you haven't explored the problem by yourself a little bit, you don't even know what question the lecture is answering. If we assume that our elementary data is a deck of cards and not just two cards, which is a reasonable thing when you deal a deck of cards, we can say that our atomic data is deck of cards. And it is the time to introduce the first function, the deal function. 8 deal 8 produce the permutation of the first 8 numbers. Going up the river with the programming. Now we have a tool to produce one permutation, but how can we produce all permutation? What other tools or function do we need? Is it right to have a function that produces all the permutation of a vector? Once generated permutation, how can we generate anagrams? And so on, and question like this. Learning APL is a journey. If we introduce APL explaining the meaning of the symbols without first proposing a series of problems, without having deeply thought about how these problems are related to each other, we risk depriving students of the experience to the journey that the inventor of the APL have done to build this language. Is mathematics or problem solving just a technical subject? Polya said the opposite. Teaching to solve problems is the education of the will. Solving problems which are not too easy for the students who learn to perceive through lack of success, to appreciate small progresses, to wait for the essential idea, to concentrate with all their might when they come up. If the student had no opportunity in the school to familiarize themselves with varying emotion of the struggle for the solution, their mathematical education would fail in the most vital point. And now we arrived to the hard question. When things get tough, student asks me, why should we study mathematics? What is the primary goal of mathematics in everyday life? And the question is very difficult. I don't know the answer, and I leave the word to poetry. I leave the word to my another student, another brilliant student, Belén.
La tortuga está en el horizonte, camina dos pasos. Ella se aleja dos pasos y el horizonte se corre 10 pasos más allá. Entonces, ¿para qué sirve la tortuga? Para eso, sirve para caminar. And now we thought that we would like to see our experience with APL through a funny video for you. Enjoy.
Ragazzi, oggi iniziamo ad usare il computer.
Many thanks to my wife for supporting me every time, Valentina and Ginevra for the choreography of the Tarantella, John Scholl for APL Sudoku Solver, Michelangelo for some illustration, Quentin Blake for his way of drawing, Ken Iverson and Roger Huey for APL, Fiona, Karen, Gita, Mort and Dyalog to be always kind to us, APL Italiana for believing in our job.
I want to say just the last one thing.
Okay. In time of crisis, in times where many people lose their job, in time where people leave our country to emigrate, we should try to be cheerful with our students, as teacher, as parents. I don't know. Can you good a good teacher? I don't know how can we improve the school. I don't know what is right. But I know what not to do. I should not enter in the classroom without a smile. I do this because I have to do it because it is a duty, and my duty as a teacher. But above all, I have to do it because it is the right to be cheerful, the right to be joyful. I think it is their most important right. Thank you very much.
Grazie.